session for this evening is Legacy Wars, the Policy of History in India. Our panelists for the session are Jamini Bhagwati, who is a former IFS officer, economist, and foreign policy expert. He was High Commissioner to the UK and the Ambassador to the European Union, Belgium, and Luxembourg. Ruchir Joshi, who is a writer, photographer, filmmaker, and columnist for the Telegraph India Today, as well as other publications. His piece, Tracing Papa, was published in Grantha 109 in a series of recollections regarding fathers. Jawahar Sarkar once again served as Secretary of the Ministry of Culture, Government of India from late 2008 to February 2012. Vikram Sampath is a historian. Vikram was awarded the Sahitya Academy Award, first Yuva Puraskar in English Literature, and the ARC International Award for Excellence in Historical India's in historical research in New York for his book on Gauhar Jaan. Anik Dotto is an Indian filmmaker, screenwriter, and lyricist who works chiefly in the Bengali film industry. Shikha Mukherjee, our moderator for this session, writes and comments on politics, regional, national, and left parties, economies, development, sustainability, and the relationship of the state to the women who live in it. Thank you so much. I would like to welcome our delegates on stage. Please have a round of applause, please.
A small announcement. Mr. Anik Dotto has regretted because of personal reasons. But the rest of them are here, and we will be starting shortly in the next 30 seconds, hopefully. Thank you for being a very patient audience, and thank you for making the first day of AKLF such a beautiful experience for all of us. We start early tomorrow at 10 with the kids' events, but here we start at 12 with a very interesting book, which is about the power of giving, which is the power of reading. And we do that with Oxfam India. And in the evening, we have some blockbuster events with Usha Uttab, Saurav Shukla, you name it, and we are giving it to you. And the best part, we are also recognizing one of the most interesting women's voices coming out from the literary world in the PKWVA, which is the PK Foundation Women's Voice Award, which is around, which is at 5 o'clock and 4 o'clock in the evening. So hope to see you all there. Please tweet, post with the hashtag AKLF2020. Sorry, and thank you again for being a wonderful audience. We will start shortly.
Welcoming the panelists for this session, Legacy Wars, the Policy of History in India, once again. The Politics of History in India, once again, Jamini Bhagwati, Ruchir Joshi, Jawahar Sarkar, Vikram Sampath, Anik Dotto, and Shikha Mukherjee are moderator for this evening.
Good evening, everybody. This session, the last in an eventful and exhilarating day, is APJ Kolkata Literary Festival's not in the least timid endeavor to provide a platform for contention free from the fears of interruption. The discussion in the public domain on legacy wars, the politics of history, engages with ideas and events that are overwhelming almost the entire population in India today. Facts in their wild profusion can be arranged and rearranged in series upon series until the frenzy of doing so over and over again can bring us to the brink of anxiety, Foucault wrote. And as much as India, others looking at what is happening in India from outside are increasingly more anxious as the days go by. A large number in this audience, and certainly some of us on this panel, are confronted with the question of identity. And as we look at our identities and begin searching for an answer on who we are, we are excavating our legacies through the papers that we hold or don't hold, which may or may not serve to establish our status as either citizens or non-citizens. The problem at this point in time in the kind of legacy wars that we are facing is that the legacy has been reduced to a single point, which is ridiculous because all of us have multiple legacies, not merely as citizens. What we need to look for is a way of approaching the issue of history, the facts that are scattered all over the place, the series of ways in which these facts are arranged and rearranged, and understand that each rearrangement is a judgment, and that judgment comes from a particular politics or an ideology or has an agenda. In many ways, the question that E.H. Carr raised, who interrogated what is history, also questioned the absolute priority of the observing subject. He wrote, "When we attempt to answer the question, what is history, our answer, consciously or unconsciously, reflects our position in time and forms part of our answers to the broader question, what view we take of the society we live in." History, as Carr said at some point, the facts of history are a bit like the fish at a fishmonger's. You choose your fish, then you decide how you're going to cook it. And at the end of the day, you might have a shoshibata or a jhol or a kalia or whatever. And that is exactly what these series of facts do. They can be arranged and rearranged to suit a particular purpose. Today's discussion, Legacy Wars, the Politics of History in India, has a very, very distinguished panel. And the distinguished panel includes two former bureaucrats, Dr. Jaimini Bhagwati and Johar Sarkar. It has a journalist, Ruchir Joshi, and then a historian, Vikram Sampath. You have a PhD, right? Yeah. So this is a very distinguished panel. And I hope it is going to be a reasonably contentious panel, because at this point in time, we are dealing with lots of legacies and lots of wars. We are dealing with history, prehistory, even myth, which has now become a kind of certified certainty, something which says that Arjun's Gandiva could fire nuclear warheads, or that the chariot used by Ravan to abduct Sita was indeed a flying chariot, which I assume was either a chopper or a vertical lift off, takeoff and landing aircraft, which could do things inside a forested area, because I don't see how any other way that liftoff could have happened. There are plenty of such other facts, including the Indian cow, the gau mata milk being deep yellow and therefore laced with gold, and myriad such facts are going around. I'm not very sure that they are facts, but this is because these are certified, they have almost acquired the status of facts in the minds of a lot of people. The legacy wars, therefore, in India have become not just a matter of who we are, what is our status as people, as individuals, but also what is the civilization and culture which is Indian. And with this distinguished panel, I will first call, I think it would be good to introduce who the panelists are, and then I'll say who's the first speaker. Dr. Bhagwati is an author and diplomat and economist. His book, The Promise of India, How Prime Ministers Nehru to Modi Shaped the Nation, kind of summarizes the performance of each of these prime ministers. And I think the subtitle of that book could very well be The Men and the One Woman Who Ruled India. Bikram Sampath is author of books as different as Gauhar Jaan, The Legendary Courtesan and Singer, Splendors of Royal Mysore, and the latest, Savarkar, Echoes from a Forgotten Past. Clearly, Savarkar is a book that looks at the legacy of Savarkar, who is a bone of contention. Whatever else Savarkar was, he is now a legacy that the Bharatiya Janata Party is reclaiming as a fearless freedom fighter and nationalist. Bikram, I'm sure, will have other things to say. Mr. Johar Sarkar, who's been with the APJ Literary Festival, Kolkata Literary Festival, all through the day, and that is a brilliant, brilliant performance, Johar, and I shokal theke. Is a student of history. No, I have to introduce you properly. Is a student of history, an interpreter of cultural history. He was a policy implementer and an interpreter of policy when he started his career as an IAS officer and then became a policymaker in his final years. As Johar said just a little while ago, he's sort of lived on both sides of the barricade. But I actually never saw him being timid on the other side. And I did see him in operation at that point. And then we have Ruchir, who is going to be the first speaker, who is a filmmaker, journalist, and author. And I think he's done I think a lot of people here are from Kolkata and may have read his latest piece in The Telegraph, in which he sort of links Kochi with Kashmir and the real estate actions usually connected to land mafias, which probably underlay the decision to abrogate Article 370. I think that Ruchir has a way of looking at facts, at looking at legacy, which would be exciting for us at this point in time. So Ruchir, over to you. The rules are that everyone makes an opening statement of between 10 and 12 minutes, and then we... What? There won't be? Yes, there will be. 8 minutes? Okay, cut it down to 8, all of you. So then we get into a short question and answer session. Ruchir, over to you.
Hello, good evening, namaskar. Greetings to my fellow panelists. Thank you for that introduction, Chika. This is a literature festival, so let me start with one of my favorite books and one of my favorite moments in that book. I'm sure a lot of you will have read or be familiar with Milan Kundera, the Czech writer Milan Kundera's book, The Book of Laughter and Forgetting. Kundera started writing under a very, very cruel and draconian Stalinist regime behind the Iron Curtain in the 50s and 60s in Czechoslovakia. In this book, he starts with a story, and the story is that when the first dictator chosen by Moscow was ruling Prague, as ruling Czechoslovakia, there's a photograph when he and his first team are gathered around each other and they're celebrating the takeover of power after the Second World War and the start of the communist regime in Prague. there is a man standing to his right, I forget his name now, who's wearing a hat. This man was very close to, the dictator at the time. After a few years, this man who was the dictator's sidekick and the dictator fell apart, and the sidekick was killed. He was sent to a camp and then executed. And then an attempt was made to remove all traces of this man from the official record. In those days, there was no Photoshop, there was no digital alteration of photos. So what they did was you would retouch it. Those who are of a certain generation in Calcutta would know that even when we got photos printed here in Bombay photo stores and other places, the little dots and stuff, flaws that would come in the negative, people would, with very small brushes, retouch. But you could also retouch quite broadly in black and white photos especially. So what the official government propaganda ministry did was to retouch all photographs which had this sidekick, this chamcha of the dictator in there, and they removed every trace of his face. But because the retouching guy was incompetent or distracted or something, in one major photograph, the guy's hat remains. So there is a hat behind the dictator, suspended in midair, and a bit of wall, almost like a Magritte painting, right? And this hat is the only trace of that associate chamcha sidekick of the dictator, who has fallen foul of him and now is gone. So that is a retouching of history. And Kundera starts from there and he says, the storytelling, the right to tell the history belongs to the victors. And the victors tell you, this is what happened, this is what happened, this is what happened, in any particular stretch of time. Recently, I've been completely addicted to a Netflix series called The Man in the High Castle. I don't know if any of you have seen it. This one imagines an alternate history where Hitler and Japan win the Second World War. The Germans manage to make a nuclear bomb. They wipe out Washington, D.C. They capture the entire eastern seaboard of the U.S. and the Japanese have the western seaboard. And there's a kind of neutral zone in between. And we're looking at 1962, when Hitler is still alive, Goebbels is still alive, Goering is still alive, Heydrich is still alive. But Hitler is dying, and internecine fighting starts between all his lieutenants in Berlin, which is the capital almost of the world at that point. And the story continues from there. That is an alternate history. When we look at our histories, we have a huge range. We have the histories that we've been taught. We have the histories that are being discovered or deepened every day. And we have histories that people imagine and put into play either as fiction or as some kind of a game. And sometimes that game is a very serious game. So, for example, this morning, Johar Babu and Willie Dalrymple were talking about company paintings, or the paintings that they don't want to, William doesn't want to call company paintings, but an alternative history emerges from Anarchy, his book, and other things, which says, yes, it was a private corporation takeover of India that happened with the East India Company, and the Indian states were absolutely complicit and funded and financed that, and Indian soldiers went in, captured all of India for roughly 2,000 white Englishmen who were in Calcutta at that time, or something like that. The other day, TCA Raghavan in the Telegraph, I don't know if you people read that, but he was talking about an alternative American history that's coming out, where it says you have to stop looking at the white version of American history, which says that the founding fathers of America stood up against the British Empire and the colonies and made the Declaration of Independence, and it was about freedom and equality, except, of course, it did not include people of color, black people, or the Native Americans. It wasn't as simple as that. The argument now is that from 1619 onwards, when the first slaves were imported from Africa to America, the entire history of the US of A, as we know it, United States of America, is actually, it was a declaration of the right to have slaves, because slavery was about to be abolished in Britain, and the slave owners in America didn't want that. So the founding fathers were all slave owners, most of them. And so American history at one level is founded on the defense of slavery, and on the other hand, genocide of the actual inhabitants of that continent, which is in what we used to call Red Indians or American Indians, and now we call Native Americans. So when we look at all these things, we realize that there is a history that we know, and then there is a deepening of that history as you explore more and more of that time. I've been working a long time to finish a second novel set in Calcutta in the Second World War. And it was a mistake to take that period because so much is emerging from that, just that period of 3 or 4 years, and my novel only covers about 2 years, that I've had my head fried completely in trying to control the amount of facts and new stories that keep coming out. That is about a deepening of history. Now, Shikha mentioned E.H. Carr and the whole notion that we have fish in a fish market. I don't eat fish, but let's just say fish in a fish market. And the fish are there, they're facts. And then we pick those fish up and we choose how to cook them. That's one thing. But what happens when someone comes to you and puts a dhokla or a misal pav in front of you and says, this is a fish, cook it. You say, that's not a fish. They say, no, no, it's a fish. And so the facts as we see them can be erased, like retouched or photoshopped or disappeared to create a completely fictional history. And that is a situation that we are facing today in this country. Most recently, a friend sent me a news item from India Today, I think, where they said, and I'm a Gujarati, so especially fills me with shame, not only the fact that Modi and Shah are ruling this country, people like them, and I'm going to name them, there's no problem, but the fact that in Gujarat, what is happening about Gandhi is so shameful. There was actually school textbooks, which was put out where it said, when Gandhi committed suicide. Now, you know, just when you thought you could not get more flabbergasted and more stunned, comes this whole notion of Gandhi committing suicide. So on the one hand, you have this criminal murderer, Nathuram Godse, being called Godse Ji, and people putting up statues of him and claiming that this man who guns down an unarmed, undefended, no security, 69, 79, however old he was, old man, is that the bravest thing that a certain so-called freedom movement can come up with, and he's a Desh Bhakt. Gandhi was a Desh Bhakt, Godse was also a Desh Bhakt. Wow, the mind boggles, right? You're talking about a completely different Desh. If Godse was a Desh Bhakt, then Gandhi was a traitor. And we have to just understand that. But on the other hand, you have this of lauding Godse and putting a crown on his head, putting a crown on Savarkar's head, or you have the craziness of Gandhi committing suicide, which is complete. All these fictions are then added on and added on. And the point I want to make is that you can do that in a country like India, because in other countries where there's a modicum of education and a level of understanding where people know what the facts are. So when you have those facts lined up, your wars or your chess game or your struggle or whatever is around those facts. They are immovable. But when you have a population, I think 40% of the adults now or something under 25, most of whom have not read history. I'm not talking about all of us sitting here, college students here who are privileged to be in Calcutta and going to some of the best colleges in the world, in this country. But people in the villages who don't know their history, who haven't been taught, who have no memory of Gujarat 2002, who have no memory of anything, or growing up, and suddenly any fiction can be fed through WhatsApp or whatever into them. So that is the legacy, and the war that we are at is that war of struggle for our past, which will determine the war, the where we take our future. Thank you.
That's a brave and bold and very clear position on legacies and histories. I would invite Dr. Bhagwati to tell us what he thinks about legacy wars, history, and politics. And I think politics needs a bit of economy added to it.
No problem. Can you hear me? Very good evening to everyone, including the distinguished panelists here. You know, when you started talking about alternative history and what if the Germans had got the A-bombs first, I forgot everything about whatever I was going to talk about I started thinking about Richard P. Feynman. If you don't know who he was, he won the Nobel Prize for Physics. And there is a book written by him and co-authored, which says, "Surely you must be joking, Mr. Feynman." And there he describes his life from his school days when he goes and repairs radios for his neighbors, and he's paid a few cents. In those days, 10 cents was a lot of money. And he calls himself a depression kid because he was growing up in the 1930s, which, as you know, was a time of tremendous economic difficulty in the United States. I'll come to the relevance to India in a minute. So he, along with Bob Oppenheimer, was part of the Los Alamos team to get to the A-bomb, to the fission bomb, before the Germans. And they did get to it way before the Germans. And somebody might say that maybe there is a God after all. This God saw to it. And why God? Because as the first test took place, the first fission explosion took place, Bob Oppenheimer and some others like Enrico Fermi, Hans Bethe, these are all very, very famous names in the world of physics, Oppenheimer started quoting from the Gita. And he knew enough Sanskrit to be able to quote from it in original. And I'll try and remember some of the words which he used. He said, "I have seen it, I have seen it, I have seen the Lord in all his splendor." This is what... Exactly. So my panelists here are very familiar with those words. But can you imagine Bob Oppenheimer? He's a Jewish physicist, just has successfully, along with, of course, several teams of physicists and engineers, exploded or tested the first nuclear fission device. And the first words which come out of his mouth as he sees the mushroom cloud is from the Gita. Why? So we in India have to think about why is it that we have to, as you were pointing out, struggle with the fact that people don't even know their basic facts. There's a lot of knowledge, there's a lot of information, there's a lot of understanding in our ancient texts. Forget about religion, abstract from religion. See them as texts that you can understand from. I had, my mother has passed away, but my first name is Jaimini, and you can imagine what a tough time I had in school, because all my classmates in class 4, class 5, "Oh, Jaimini, you're a girl's name, Padmini, Rukmini. What kind of a name is that?" So you see, if you have an ambitious mother, and there was a Jaimini Muni who wrote the fifth system of Hindu philosophy. Again, abstract from the Hinduism and all that stuff. There has been a lot of learning, and I just met somebody who was heading the Max Müller Institute here in Kolkata, and we all know how knowledgeable Max Müller was about our ancient texts. So when we are talking about legacy wars, when we talk about rewriting history, we should first understand who we are and where we have come from and what a rich tradition of learning we have come from. So when somebody, one feels pained now, when, and I'm going to now cut straight to independence because I'm watching how many minutes I've used up. Now there is this false narrative, false in my understanding, that there's something that would have been very different in our country if Sardar Patel had been the first prime minister. And you know, this man, this anglicized Nehru, this idiot, who didn't understand anything about India. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel worked very hard to go to England to study. And they all spoke and wrote very well in English, although Sardar Patel failed his high school because he couldn't clear his mathematics. But we won't go there. Why did Gandhi choose Nehru? In my humble understanding is because he saw that Nehru had the qualities of head and most importantly heart to lead the country as the first prime minister. And Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel accepted that. So now whether you make a 700-meter, 7-kilometer high statue, it does not detract from Nehru. I greatly respect, admire Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and all that he did for the country, including getting all the princely states to accede to India. But this is a sort of, you know, kind of rewriting of history. They were great friends. And one more little anecdote. It seems Nehru had gone to the railway station, perhaps Delhi, somewhere else. I can't remember from the text I read about it. But I can tell you that this is a real story which has been authenticated. He was going to say goodbye to Gandhi and to Kasturba. And as he was about to say goodbye, Kasturba ji turned to him and said, God be with you, in some language. I don't know whether in Hindi or in Gujarati. And Nehru, this is somewhere around 41 or so, Quit India Movement. They haven't yet been imprisoned. And he exploded. He started yelling at Kasturba ji, saying, what God? Where is this God? Look at Nazi Germany. Look at what they are doing to the Jews. And Gandhi turned to Kasturba, not to Nehru, and said, forgive him. He's much nearer to God than both of us. So, you know, today when we hear of all this stuff, so now I'll switch a little bit to economics because the moderator referred to my background in economics. Again, you have this nonsense about the Hindu rate of growth. I mean, it's all very good. Why Hindu? Why, you know, call it anything but Hindu rate of growth. Hindu rate of growth is 3%. What was the rate of growth between 1900 to 1947? Does anybody here know what was the average rate of growth? 0.8%. Population growing at 1.5 for some time initially, but as health, public health facilities improved, we shot up to 2.5. That means every year our per capita income was decreasing. From 1947 to 1964, when Nehru died, the average rate of growth was 3 to 3.5%. I can't remember the exact number. Obviously not a round number like 3 or 3.5%. Okay, we cut immediately to Indira Gandhi. And I think I have 2 minutes left. So, disaster. And I think this kind of rewriting of history about how others were responsible. Some authors have come up with this. Will not mention the author's name because I know him personally, who says that P.N. Haxar was responsible for all the left of center policies and not Indira Gandhi. But I don't know who was prime minister because P.N. Haxar was removed from the prime minister's office and P.N. Dhar was put in his place. I mean, you know, for heaven's sake, she has to be given credit for having created or helped in the creation of Bangladesh. She has to be given all the blame for what she did to our economy. And now there is also this stuff, and now cut to the current situation, because now I have just 1 minute left. What is going on in our country? As was being pointed out a little while ago, why is it that, I don't think it's a question of just education. I think it's also a question of our mindsets. In 1947, when Nehru gave everybody a vote, which I think was the seminal one act which has changed this country. Why is it that people are not aware? I think there is a resistance to learn about ourselves. And I think we'll not get into these from legacy wars to class wars, but there is a class element to this. We are speaking in English, and maybe less than 2% of our country could have understood. So there is a certain elitism which we need to shed to avoid these kind of legacy wars in understanding the basics about our Indian history and what we are as a people. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhagwati. In fact, I'm sort of missing Sujata Gidla because she would have brought in a perspective on what legacies mean and what the politics and history has done to this over 50% of the population, meaning the Dalits, the most vulnerable and the most marginalized. There is a perspective that we need to bring in beyond this cultural interpretation of facts, beyond this political interpretation of facts, which is the civilizational burden and oppression that has been meted out to crores of this people through millennia. And Ruchir was talking about the alternative histories. The Dalits have an alternative history to tell, as do the tribals, as do other communities within India. And this homogenization of India into the majority and the minority sort of displaces these other legacies, other conflicts, other confrontations, other exploitations, other marginalizations that, in fact, Dr. Bhagwati referred to by saying that this is an elite. We are engaging in an elite conversation. I would request Dr. Sampat.
I was half hoping that the historian would be the last in the panel on history. I'm probably reminded while I listen to all my eminent co-panelists about what drew me first to history. I remember as a student in class 6 or 7, someone who was not really very fond of the history that was taught in school, the pedantic way that we are made to learn by rote who succeeded whom and which war was fought, none of which I actually comprehended, and almost ended every history class kneeling down outside the class. And my history teacher might have already had a heart attack too when she knows that I am now counted among historians of the country. But there was this serial, and I bring that up because the topic is about legacy. You know, there was a serial on television, I'm sure many of you would know, called The Sword of Tipu Sultan, on the only channel that we all saw, Doordarshan. And there were these two competing narratives that were going on. You had the Hindu royal family of Mysore, the Wodeyars, and then you had Tipu Sultan and his father, Hyder Ali, who had usurped the kingdom from them and resulted in a 40-year interregnum, in their rule. Now, you can well imagine the kind of potpourri for disaster, considering all the religious connotations that come into it. But the serial made it worse, because just to amplify the greatness of both Hyder and Tipu, you had the Wodeyar, the Maharaja, was shown, I don't know how many of you remember, as this obese retard who was dancing along with the court dancer. The Maharani was shown as one of those vamps from those Ekta Kapoor serials, who's all the time conspiring, to overthrow Tipu Sultan. And I'm talking about, say, 2 decades ago, where probably things were not as volatile as they are today, but there were still protests in different parts of southern Karnataka about this portrayal, and very well-meaning protests, apolitical protests, about people who held this particular royal family in great regard and respect. And here was this boy, me, who was disinterested in history, and I set out on a completely self-motivated and, more importantly, self-funded journey to find out the truth behind, or the truth as we can probably see, behind this portrayal. And through these 20, 25 years that I've been associated with this discipline, I see the perils, the landmines that it presents. There was somebody, a famous historian abroad, who had said, every account of history is an interim report, because what people did in the past is not preserved in amber, it is not immutable, and every generation looks back and draws from its own experience and attempts to illuminate the present and the future. And history, and very ironically in a country like ours, where we have so little regard for history or documentation or preservation of monuments, characters of history and their legacy, they become something that we are so touchy about. Cut back to Tipu Sultan that I was talking, I started off with. Today, Tipu is a political landmine in my home state, Karnataka, on both sides of the political spectrum. On the one hand, you have a Congress government which would commemorate a Tipu Sultan Jayanti, and that too, they don't even get the date right. He was born on 20th November and they've been celebrating it on 10th November. I've been trying to tell them that at least get your date right, basic facts, the basic fish or the dhokla. So even that is not there, so what the motivations are. And at the same time, you have Tipu Sultan, who also had some of the earliest foundries, the rockets that he created. the foundries and the rocket manufacture places are in dire disarray in different parts of Karnataka. Now, that is not preserved. But then he becomes this political landmine, so to say. And obviously, on the other side, you have the rabid kind of opposition to him, considering the fact that he was also a medieval ruler who was bigoted, who was a tyrant, who, a large number of Syrian Christians, Hindus, and other communities were persecuted. Now, in this crossfire between political ideologies of today, where we end up judging characters of the past by yardsticks we set today, was Tipu secular? Was Tipu communal? Was he a nationalist? Was he an anti-national, the famous word in these days? I mean, these things didn't even exist then. What secularism are you talking about in the 18th century? Similarly, when there was no concept of a nation state, what freedom, he was India's first freedom fighter. What freedom was he fighting for when he was actually fighting to preserve his own honor, his own kingdom, and so on? So these, I think the biggest peril that I have noticed, and to be an objective historian is a big trouble, because you are immediately bracketed and put into those boxes, because you have to be labeled. In today's India, you just cannot go without any labels. You have to be labeled as left and right and this and that, which you need not be. You can just be in the center, quite coincidentally the way I'm sitting in this panel too, where you can draw a little from either side. So these competing, narratives become the problem area. And I'm always, reminded of that famous poem that we read as children, of the blind men and the elephant. You know, all the blind men touching different parts of the elephant and saying the elephant looks like the trunk, the elephant looks like the tail, the elephant is like this and that, and each of them is right and each of them is wrong. It's a sum of parts. That's exactly how historical narratives are, where I may have written the best book with the best of research at my command, but tomorrow it can be overturned by anybody just by the fact that some new perspective has come about, some new research element has come about. The problem I feel in India, and Indian historiography in particular, is that for the longest time, it has become the handmaiden of, as always, of the ruler. And George Orwell had famously said that he who controls the past controls the present and the future. And political parties do understand this, and they do play with history, and this is the sensitive issue that that can fire up people. And ironically, I think since the time of the establishment of the Indian Council for Historical Research, ICHR, the thraldom with which Indian historiography has been held by one particular ideological group, I think that has done a lot of harm to Indian history writing. We talk about alternative narratives. Of course, there are these loony narratives which you mentioned right at the beginning of those aircrafts and so on. But also, the space that needs to be given in academia, in historiography, to any narrative which goes beyond what is the official narrative has never been happening in India. And I think that is a big bane, which and careers have been destroyed of people who have held any views outside the straitjacket of what the official account is. Now, today maybe it's still possible that I can write whatever, an objective biography of Savarkar, but just 3-4 decades back, someone like a Hridaynath Mangeshkar, nonetheless, someone of his eminence, and he was working in the All India Radio, and Savarkar was a great poet in Marathi, and a lot of his poetry, Ni Majasine, Sagara Prana Talmalala, which is a very famous poem, Jayostute, these were all set to tune and sung by the Mangeshkar sisters. For this, Hridaynath Mangeshkar actually got sacked from All India Radio for popularizing a figure who was persona non grata. Now, we do talk about Hitler and so on, but at least in the West, even to criticize someone, you're allowed to write about that person, you're allowed to study about that person, and then make an informed judgment either for or against that person. And I think that is how intellectual freedom and academics should work. Now, you cannot make up your mind and actually we're talking about, untouchables and suppression, but actually there are characters of the past who are anathema to any kind of assessment. You can hate a person, you can hate an ideology, you can like that or whatever, but before that, please, there has to be space for dialogue, there has to be space for an alternative view to come as well. And particularly, I think when these get appropriated by groups, it becomes extremely difficult to make that objective assessment. Today, I shudder to think, I mean, can me as a historian write, say, a biography of Ambedkar, probably bringing out all his follies, which he would have as a human being, a Periyar, a Shivaji. I mean, we saw what happened at the Bhandarkar Institute with Lane and the entire. And likewise, I mean, Arun Shauri had this worshipping false gods that he wrote on Ambedkar, and hell broke loose. So when we're talking of legacy wars, I think, unfortunately, and it pains me as a historian, that my discipline has been captured by vested political interests who have absolutely no interest in the discipline at all. But then the whole idea is to fan contemporary sentiments among people. You have captured the narrative so much that any kind of assessment of these people becomes almost impossible. And in that process, I think the future generations are the casualty, where the true story, in whatever way it is there, there's nothing called a true story, it's all interim report, as I said. Even that interim report does not reach the next generation. Thank you.
Thank you, Vikram. I would now request Johar.
I'm her uncle, Shia, that's why she gave me last, her father's friend. There was a lot of discussion about the type of history we read, the basically what type of shoe we need to wear. Now, I'm going to come to a stage when we had no feet. Absolutely. Exactly 200 years, 3 months from today, we had no constructed history of ancient India. I'm saying that with authority and sticking my neck out like a giraffe. Exactly 200 years ago, the first discussion about the first edifice of the pre-Islamic period, first major edifice, Amravati report was being read down this road to number 1 Park Street, Asiatic Society, 200 years ago. Amravati was discovered by accident during the Seringapatnam campaign. It was discovered in 1791, 92, but it was brought out as a paper in 1819, another thing happened. An army captain chasing a deer stumbled upon Ajanta. We had erased our minds of Ajanta. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to bring you back to the stage when collective amnesia of a Brahmanical order had selected facts that we need to know and forget the rest. There was complete amnesia about the entire glory of the Buddhist past. Buddhist, remember. Move fast forward, in 1851, Sanchi was discovered. In 1851, Sanchi was discovered, but more interesting, I come to 1836-37 when the debates were going on in the Asiatic Society, and a lean young man of 29, who died at the age of 31 or 32, was arguing and interpreting a language that Indians had completely forgotten, Old Brahmi. And while going through this Old Brahmi inscription, he stumbled upon a character that India had completely, Brahmanical history had completely chosen to omit from all references. He was something like Betal, a person who exists, a Vikramaditya who may have existed, may not have existed. And this man who was reinstated by this young fellow who died exactly 4 years after in the Asiatic Society was James Princep, and the language was Old Brahmi. The character he resurrected was Ashok. We had no idea of Ashok Maurya. What history are you talking about? Exactly 200 years ago, you had no idea of Ajanta. In fact, Ajanta, we have forgotten the name of the caves. We have forgotten, we have rediscovered it, but now it's too late. Because we have forgotten the name of the caves are named after the village there. The village name is Ajanta. It's not Ajanta Caves. That's not the right name. So this is the amount of project amnesia that was rolled over our minds, and selective patches of history was retained. So move fast forward, we find this Chanakya's book in 1905, Shama Shastri. Move fast forward, 1922, we stumbled upon Mohenjo-daro in a bit, and Harappa. Do you know when the first time it comes in the textbooks? 1956 in Calcutta University, the first to be actually using it. Till 1956, we had no knowledge of 3,500 years of Indian history. So Indian history has been a labor of love. Indian history has been reconstructed and retrofitted. Once the narrative is retrofitted, you go on choosing which shoes to wear, gum boots or jack boots or whatever. So the fact is that historians had to reconstruct our entire linear history. Our history was basically cyclical. Anyway, Jamini, a good friend of mine, mentioned about the Gita and the explosion that reminded the atomic explosion. Do you know that the Gita itself was reconstructed and retrofitted into our psyche exactly 150 years ago? And what proof is there? Krishna's legend, and if you go through the entire visual history's cultural history rests on two models. Either you have Bala Krishna, the child Krishna, or you have Radha Krishna. He is resting on either a woman or a child. Okay. Now, the Krishna of the Gita, the guy who turns back and sort of keeps advising Arjuna, is not found in a single sculptural or visual representation. These are all constructs. But now, I am known to be quite opposed to the regime, I'll agree with Vikram on one account, that the history that was produced between the 50s and now was monopolized by one group of left Marxist historians. Now, what's wrong about it? I mean, in the sense that they had their own viewpoints. History was outsourced by the Congress to the left, Sidhi Baat. It was outsourced. And no other point of view was taken. Now, when he takes up Savarkar, and I have been a bitter opponent of Savarkar, as a student of history, let me tell you, Savarkar had been the greatest critic of Hindu excesses. You don't know. Savarkar had mocked the 33 crore Hindu gods. Savarkar had mocked those who believe in rituals. Savarkar was a brutal rationalist who did not believe in 90% of what constitutes Hinduism. But he was a father of Hindutva. So when you look back at history, you can't look at it with a jaundiced eye. If I have been bitterly attacking the regime from morning, if the counterpoint of view can be presented properly, as a liberal, I should say, please read it. Please read it. Because a true liberal is not one who behaves like a fascist. He leaves all the intolerance to fascists. But a true liberal is one who's willing to see the other side as well. So history has to be, the immediate provocation for this was Amit Shah making that Amit Shah type statement, ki history banana hai hume, in Banaras Hindu University in November. What history, what banayenge aap? This is the case of our history, and this ancient history, this glorious ancient history of India that we all take pride and we arrogate, we appropriate every goddamn good scientific invention that happened in the preceding 3,000 years to some Hindu. If he had really invented the flying machine, why didn't he tell the Wright brothers not to come on the scene? I mean, so you can't go on this zigzag thing. You can't go on. You have to be rational. We have to be rational. We have to accept that Savarkar had two sides. He had prompted, evidence notwithstanding, he had prompted Godse. And Godse went and murdered Mahatma Gandhi. No doubt about it. But Savarkar himself was a scientific rationalist. He was not a hardcore Hindu in the sense we understand. So when you look at each character, you'll come across this. The last point that I would submit is, why did I suddenly blurt out about the left Marxist interpretation? Because I am a fellow traveler. I did it because irreparable harm has been done to our system. This absolutely demeaning way of looking at Indian mythology has caused the Indian people to move away from us to them. When you talk of pushbacks and this and that. Of course, I ridiculed in the social media as well. We have a super intelligent governor who wants to fly that pushback Viman or whatever. Point is, why do we mock beliefs? Who comes up and mocks Jesus walking on water? Who comes up and ridicules Jesus coming out on the fourth day, coming out of his grave on the fourth day, third day? See, there will be a certain amount of mythology built into every religion. Have the big heart to tolerate it. Don't go around mocking it. The fact that we went on continuously mocking Ram and Ram's existence has led us to this state when you are caught by the throat and said, Ab bolo Shri, Jai Shri Ram. Ab bolo Jai Shri Ram. We have moved from the people. This historical interpretation that went in for excessive scientific interpretation was elitist, is elitist, and has delinked the liberals of India, detached the liberals of India from the reality of India, which has been cleverly appropriated by the two rather healthy gentlemen from Gujarat. Do I have time? Hey. Okay, I think we'll leave it at that. So my submission is that the history that we take supreme pride in wasn't there. B, it was reconstructed in the last exactly 200 years. C, that now we go in for a reinterpretation of the reconstruction, retrofitted history. D, that there are histories that are yet to be discovered. E, that we don't need to take a monocled view on persons and views. And let the other voice prevail. You might be surprised at me saying so, but I say that if India has to go on, India has to factor in the fact that millions have actually voted for a person and for an ideology. If we ignore that ideology and keep mocking it, we'd be doing disservice to our intellect and we'll never be able to win the battle back. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Johor. We have a very little time left to us. I had hoped to be able to ask questions, but could I? Can we stretch this, Anju? 5 minutes? Okay. Okay. So we could do two things. Let me just ask a couple of questions quickly. One is that between liberal, left, and the right, and these interpretations of history, I think what we are missing out is that there are the small voices of history, and those have not been discussed at all. I think the absence of Sujata is really a big void. Because she comes from a background which has its own interpretation of history and the legacies that we are talking about. No one can make up for her. No one can make up for her because that comes from a particular sensitivity which we are not capable of. You would like to ask?
After.
Okay. So I think since Dr. Bhagwati wants to make a point on this, we will allow him to go forward.
Very quickly. You know, I don't know how many of you here are familiar with a film called Rashomon, yeah, by Kurosawa. I mean, here we are talking about history which is written with some distance in time. But Rashomon tells us that immediately after an event, and it was widely acclaimed because people could relate to what was being said. And there are four different versions of the same event within minutes of it happening. So I think we have to live with the fact that people will interpret exactly the same events in very different ways based on their personal self-interest or based on their ideology. So the only way we can get around this is to read all the versions and to listen to everyone, which is another way of saying that be open in your understanding of issues, and perhaps you'll get a little closer, never get to the truth, but maybe a little closer to the truth.
I think there's always room for more than one way of looking at facts and the evidence and leaving truth to a debate on philosophy. I think that's what the historian should do instead of claiming that they have uncovered the truth, because I don't think the truth is something that historians can really uncover, because there are so many truths. Ruchir?
I think the important lesson that we must take away from here is, as Vikram said, we have to read and be open, because that's the, unless your mind is open, nothing is going to get in. As Johar Babu said, and Vikram pointed out, and Dr. Bhagwati, you know, there have been all kinds of skewerings of history. I mean, I've lived most of my life under a Stalinist regime of the CPM, so, and I was in presidency, so we know at least what it's like to step out of line or even have a look with a slightly critical eye at anything that had to do with communism or leftism or the Indira Gandhi brand of socialism. I think a lot of things need to be, the balance needs to be redressed. I think we need to be open. I think we need to take this critical moment where we are under such horrible pressure as human beings, as a population, from these two healthy gentlemen, as you call them. I think we have to take this as an opportunity to say, let's ask ourselves the hard questions that we are demanding everybody else to ask. I think that's the main takeaway that I'm getting from something that we've all said. And therefore, you know, you have, if you do that, then you can have a proper struggle over legacy.
I'm not sure where that leaves legacy, because I think there are legacies, there are legacies and legacies and legacies, and we have identities and identities and identities, none of which necessarily are better or more critical or prior to any other identity or legacy that we may or may not have.
Shikha, yeah. I spoke for the liberals when we said, let us listen to the other voice. But the hard truth of today is the other voice operates mainly through WhatsApp, where lies are packed. You see the amount of defamatory, incriminatory stuff that they've given on Nehru, from sexual diseases to God knows what. I mean, just because one fat man doesn't like him, many of us are critical of him as well, doesn't mean that you have to go to those dirty depths and pump the social media, pump the world with fakes. That is the difference between a liberal and a fanatic. We are fighting fanatics, but at the same time, we should not forget that we should not become fanatics in our own way. We have to disdain. That is the, what they taught me in St. Xavier's was, when you're fighting and your opponent is down, do not attack him. Give him his sword back, let him get up. It's very difficult. I know it's very difficult to do these things, but they have to be done if sanity is to be restored to this nation. The time has come for those who have won to try to write their version. But after this phase will pass, and this phase shall pass, I can give you that much assurance. We did that for Indira Gandhi as well. This phase shall pass not because of 1,000 mutinies. This phase shall pass because of the same reason that Indira Gandhi went away. Hubris, excessive pride, excessive confidence, and a bundle of mistakes, starting with CA. But anyway, as soon once this regime goes, the products, the historical products of this regime will have to be read together with the earlier Marxist-dominated history, and we have to come to our own judgments. Koi hamare dimag to kharidne liya na.
Johar, I just have one other thing to say to you, to be provocative, which is that, true, you're talking about reading and more reading, but if you look at what CAA or the NRC or the NPR is doing, is that it is bringing people out to claim...
Hang on.
To claim...
Let him make a mistake.
To claim their legacy as well as their identities through a process which is political. There, the history is the history of every individual who is out on the streets. They are not reading the text. They are not in, they are not looking at it as left or liberal or whatever, but they are looking at their individual histories and saying that this is a process where, which does not, which does not represent me, the Indian, as a citizen, as a person, with these multiple identities, of which being just, the citizen is, after all, the basic, taken for granted definition of who is an Indian. I am not an Indian just because I am certified as a citizen.
We are talking, Shikha, we can just end with one quote. And this one was by Napoleon. Marshal Grouchy, his field marshal, was standing next to him when the British were firing their shells and they were falling short. The French had better guns. So he went up and said, "Mon Emperor, do we give them a taste of French steel?" He didn't reply. He went on saying, "My Emperor, do we give them a taste of French steel? They're making so many mistakes." Napoleon looked up, short guy, looked up and said, "Never interrupt a fool or your enemy when he's making mistakes. It is bad manners to the French."
Okay.
Except that his mistakes are costing innocent lives every day. When you are gunning down people who are just walking on the streets because they happen to be of a certain religion or something, and your police has the permission to just shoot them down, that their mistakes will bring them down.
But do you know what they're doing now?
I'm also a writer and a filmmaker.
No, but apart from that, I mean, do you know what they're doing now? I was horrified to hear from my colleagues in Uttar Pradesh that a section of the police are carrying private weapons.
Not
private
surprising.
Weapons.
And there's a police
Mitra
Mandal.
Not from 303 or 7.62 SLR, but from private weapons, so that the wounds and injuries that we found are
can
from
claimed
private
weapons.
I mean, how low can you sink?
Lower and lower. So this is the problem with letting the mistakes continue. You know, anyway.
I think, I just had half a sentence to say that I think the discussion and our invocation of the two healthy men just proves that how much, what I said, I think, earlier, that how our discussion about history has so totally been hijacked by politics that it's so difficult. And in a polarized society like today, it becomes very difficult to evaluate a subject like this in a dispassionate manner, because passions do run high when it comes to politics.
I don't know. I think would some no? Okay. I've been overruled. I was hoping that we could have questions from the audience, but I've been overruled, and so I will just thank the panelists for an exciting discussion and a contentious one. Thank you.
Ending the last session of the day of AKLF 2020, the 11th edition, on such a profound note, I would like to once again thanks our delegates Jamini Bhagwati, Ruchir Joshi, Johar Sarkar, Vikram Sampath, and Shikha Mukherjee, requesting them to move to the delegates' lounge. The book signing lounge again is to my right, and the food lounge is to my left. A vote of thanks for all the audience for sticking around and making AKLF a success. Thank you so much. We will be absolutely nothing without you. Announcement of the book signing sessions. Thanking the sponsors and partners, I would like to thank all the sponsors and partners. Our food partner, Chabar Flurries, our delegate lounge partner, Taifu, our tea partner, Karma Kettle, our food partner, True South, South Indian Filter Coffee, partners David and Goliath, Prabha Khaitan Foundation, the Teachers Center. Session partners are Karamchand Thapar Foundation, Kuwar Viyogi Memorial Trust, Oxfam India, hospitality partner EB's Kolkata, radio partner 91.9 Friends FM, wellness partner Amri. Institutional partners are Tollygunj Club Limited, Getty Institute, Max Muller Bhavan, Alios for CES, Pro Helvetia, our Swiss institutional partner, Consulate General of Italy, Australian Consulate General. US Consulate, the British Council, the Creative Arts, our quiz partner, Calcutta Heritage Collective, event partner, Navkrit Brand Solutions Private Limited. For more details about our programs and our panelists, kindly check the website www.aklf.in. Thank you so much. So we'll just be wrapping up the session for the day. Thank you.